Welcome to our time of study in God's Word. This is study number one in our series through the book of 1 Samuel. And our study today is titled The Barren Wife. And we're going to look at 1 Samuel 1, 1 through 8. Would you please join me now in prayer? Father, we just thank you so much for this time that you've given to us to open God's Word, to consider all that this great book has to say to us. And Lord, I just pray now for our time of study as we consider 1 Samuel 1, 1 through 8. Lord, that you would help us, that you would help those who are facing infertility and doubting your word and struggling, God, in this particular area, that as we consider what it has to say, God, that we would see that there is hope and there is hope in you alone. You are a God of hope. And that we can take refuge in you alone. And so, Lord, we pray for illumination today. We pray for your help. We pray for your grace, both for those who listen and for me as I teach from your word now. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, if you have your Bibles, go ahead and open them to 1 Samuel. 1 Samuel. 1 Samuel 1, 1 through 8 says this. There was a certain man of Ramathaim Zophim, try saying that five times, of the hill country of Ephraim, whose name was Elkanai, the son of Jeroham, the son of Elihu, son of Tohu, son of Zuf, an Ephraimite. He had two wives. The name of one was Hannah, and the name of the other was Panay. And Panay had children, but Hannah had none. And now this man used to go up year by year from his city to worship and to sacrifice to the Lord of hosts at Shiloh, where the two sons of Eli, Hophni and Phinehas, were priests of the Lord. And on the day when Elkanai sacrificed, he would give portions to Panay, his wife, and to all her sons and daughters. But to Hannah he gave a double portion, because he loved her, though the Lord had closed her womb. And a rival used to provoke her grievously to irritate her because the Lord had closed her womb. And so it went on year by year. As often as she went up to the house of the Lord, she used to provoke her. And therefore Hannah wept and would not eat. And Elkanai, her husband, said to her, Hannah, why do you weep? And why do you not eat? And why is your heart sad? Am I not more to you than 10 sons? This is the reading of God's holy, inspired, inerrant, sufficient, clear, and authoritative Word of God. Most people think of David as one of the Bible's great romantic heroes. Believers of Scripture will not doubt his historical significance. But it is David, the man, who captures the imagination. And accordingly, most sermons on the hero of 1 Samuel will focus on ways in which David's example is deemed relevant to us today. For many, David is the model young Christian as he stands before the giant Goliath, armed with only his shepherd's sling and his faith in the Lord God. And we also witness David living out the struggles of young adulthood in an unfair world. David provides a model of Christian leadership. Not only does he face the obstacles of his own life and calling, but his leader behavior also plays a decisive role in forging the kingdom he will lead. With all these points of contact with readers, to which we would add David, the poet and singer of Psalms, it is no wonder that believers in every generation feel such a strong bond with David. For all the fascination of the romantic David, however, the discerning Christian will realize an even stronger interest in David as one of the Old Testament's principal types or models of Jesus Christ. It is an anointed one, also called and provided by God himself to lead Israel, that David plays his chief role in redemptive history and makes his distinctive contribution in preparing God's people for the anointed one, the Messiah, who comes to rule and to save. Now, scholars agree that the theological center of the Samuel corpus rests in 2 Samuel 7, which records God's covenant promise of an eternal throne from the line of David. And this being the case, the center of 1 Samuel occurs in chapter 16 of 1 Samuel, where the prophet judge Samuel anoints David to that royal office. Everything beforehand is prologue to David's anointing, and all the fascinating plot tensions that follow result from David's having been set apart as the king after God's own heart, 1 Samuel 3:14 says. Now, the theme of David as Israel's anointed one is especially highlighted in his epic battle with the giant Goliath, when the youthful shepherd arrives unexpectedly to grant victory over foes too strong for the people of God. Now, to be sure, in this and other great passages, David remains a fascinating subject of interest as an example for our faith. And the traditional perspective on David, the man of faith, remains a valid approach in expositing 1 Samuel. And yet, above merely serving as an example, David more importantly directs us to the promised Savior who is the object of our faith. Now, not everything David does in 1 Samuel is Christ-like, far from it. But as the anointed one in his own time, he begins to show God's people how the true Messiah will bring salvation to his needy people for all time. Despite the attention on David, 1 Samuel also presents two other significant figures. In the book's namesake, Samuel, we meet an important figure in Scripture whose significance equals that of Joshua, Moses' successor. Samuel's place in redemptive history is greatly underestimated by most students of Scripture. His life and ministry play an important role in the Bible story and provide an inspiration that rivals that associated with David. It was Samuel whom God used to guide Israel out of the chaos of the period of the judges and to serve the coming of the kingdom in the arrival of David. And standing next to Samuel is Saul, who served as the alter ego first to Samuel, then to David, and who embodies the idolatry and unbelief that will plague Israel throughout the rest of the Old Testament. By means of the contrast between Saul and Samuel and David, the narrative of 1 Samuel will present numerous valuable lessons for us to consider. Together with these main figures, the lesser characters in 1 Samuel are hardly incidental, including Eli, the corrupted priest, Hannah, the tearful believer, and Jonathan, the faithful friend, just to name a few. Now, let's look at 1 Samuel 1, 1 through 8, which says again this. There was a certain man of Ramiathan Zophim of the hill country of Ephraim, whose name was Elkanah, the son of Jeroham, the son of Eli, the son of Tohu, the son of Zuph, an Ephraimite. He had two wives. The name of the one was Hannah, and the name of the other Penai. And Penai had children, but Hannah had no children. And now this man used to go up year by year from his city to worship and to sacrifice to the Lord of hosts at Shiloh, where the two sons of Eli, Hophni and Phinehas, were priests of the Lord. On the day when Elkanah sacrificed, he would give portions to Penai, his wife, and to all her sons and daughters. But to Hannah he gave a double portion because he loved her, though the Lord had closed her womb. And a rival used to provoke her grievously to irritate her because the Lord had closed her womb. And so it went on year by year. As often as she went up to the house of the Lord, she used to provoke her. And therefore Hannah wept and would not eat. And Elkanah, her husband, said to her, Hannah, why do you weep? And why do you not eat? And why is your heart sad? Am I not more to you than 10 sons? You see, among the treasures of our world are the great stories that shape the identity of whole peoples. Homer's Iliad provided the ancient Greeks with a literary foundation on which centuries of great culture were erected. Out of the chaos of the Dark Ages, the Britons founded a noble ideal in the story of King Arthur and Camelot. More ancient than either of these is the Old Testament book of Samuel, with his story of the rise of King David and the establishment of Israel's kingdom. As literature, Samuel is unsurpassed in the richness of his plot, the complexity and depth of its characters, the intensity of its action, and the profundity of its lessons. This is all the more the case when we realize that Samuel is not a fictional character, but a true historical narrative. These people lived on our earth, and these events happened in our world. Homer and King Arthur inspire us through their fantasy world of heroes, maidens, and monsters. Samuel refuses to yield the palm when it comes to these. But Samuel's importance lies not only in that the story is true, but also in that it forms a part of the unfolding story of God's salvation that is the greatest truth of all. You see, Samuel was born sometime around the year 1050 BC. Judges 21:25 says this, "In those days, there was no king in Israel. Everyone did what was right in his eyes." This summarizes the condition of the nation at the time of Samuel's birth. Israel faced a leadership crisis that was accompanied by a spiritual crisis. Having entered the promised land in victory and strength, the people of God had lost their way spiritually, politically, and militarily. Judges 2:10 explains why. "After Joshua and his generation, there arose another generation after them who did not know the Lord." You see, forgetting the Lord is the greatest evil that can befall any generation. Absent God's help, Israel failed to drive out the remnants of the Canaanites, but instead began to follow in their pagan ways and to worship their unholy idols. In punishment, God gave the Israelites over to the hands of their enemies, periodically showing mercy by raising up judges to deliver them. The book of Judges concludes with a series of stories that depict the decadent setting into which Samuel was born and raised, including the spiritual corruption of the Levites, the idolatry of the people, and the moral squalor of Israelite society. The birth of Samuel portended a new age. It begun a new age. Just as God would later prepare Israel for her Messiah by sending John the Baptist, God prepared the way for a king after God's own heart by sending Samuel, who was at once the last of Israel's judges and the first of the great line of the prophets who served during Israel's kingdom. David Tesmora observes this. "Samuel takes the decisive role in the period of transition from the days of the judges to the monarchical era, leading to the establishment of the house of David and the beginning of the worship of Yahweh in Jerusalem." The historical significance of Samuel is evidenced by the birth narrative that begins the two books of the Bible that bear his name. And now the scriptures always take care to inform us of the birth and the upbringing of its most important figures, and so it does here. Just as Moses, Samson, John the Baptist, and Jesus Christ were all born in times of distress to humble godly parents, Samuel enters history as a child of Elkanah and Hannah. 1 Samuel 1:1 says this, "There was a certain man of Ramathon Zophim of the hill country of Ephraim, whose name was Elkanah, the son of Jehoram, the son of Elihu, son of Jehu, son of Zuph, an Ephraimite." Say that a few times fast if you want to have a tongue twister. Samuel's father was a certain man, hardly a description for someone of prominence. We are told two things about Elkanah, starting with the place where he lived. Ramathon Zophim was a small town in the heart of Israel, belonging to the territory allotted to Ephraim, not far from its border with Judah, about 5 miles north of what would later be the city of Jerusalem. Samuel would put Ramah, as it was later called, on the map, making it Israel's virtual capital during his judgeship, and founding there the school of the prophets. Neither Elkanah nor Samuel was an Ephraimite, however. They traced their lineage through Tophu to Zuph, who was an Ephraimite, a denizen of the region of Bethlehem in the land of Judah. And moreover, theirs was a priestly family of the tribe of Levi and the clan of Kohath, as we learn in 1 Chronicles 6:33-38. The Kohathites were originally charged with guarding the Ark of the Covenant and serving as the tabernacle's gatekeepers. Now, under David, the sons of Kohath were dedicated to the ministry of song in the tabernacle. Samuel's grandson, Heman, is denoted as the singer and seems to have enjoyed the enormous privilege of serving as the music director for Israel's worship under David. Samuel's descendants were probably among the sons of Korah, to whom the authorship of 11 Psalms is described. Now, the primary focus in Samuel's birth is not on his father, but on his mother, Hannah. We see, we can often trace the faith of remarkable children to their remarkable mothers. And so it is with this woman who presents one of the most striking feminine characters in the Bible. Robert Burgens observes that the spiritual powerhouse in this narrative was a socially impotent woman who alone understood the true power of undivided faith in the Lord. Now, there's much to say about this extraordinary woman, but at the time, there was one fact that dominated her existence. Hannah's womb was closed, so she was unable to bear Elkanah any children. And after telling us that Hannah is Elkanah's wife, the Bible simply reports Hannah had no children, 1 Samuel 1:2 says. Now, Hannah's barrenness seems to correspond with Israel's spiritual state. Women who suffer this condition often wonder how God is involved. But in Hannah's case, we know the text informs us that the Lord has closed her womb, 1 Samuel 1:5 says. Now, there are many reasons why God brings important trials into the lives of his people, often to stimulate our faith. But in the case of a mother of so important a figure as Samuel, the point has to do not with Hannah, but with Israel. The Lord closed Hannah's womb to remind Israel that he had also caused the people to be spiritually barren because of their idolatry and unbelief. Israel was God's barren wife, having failed to give him the children of faith he desired. As a nation, Israel particularly manifested her barrenness and the resultant lack of the strong leadership of a true king. You see, the situation in Elkanah's family is intended as a parable of Israel's situation at this moment in history. Hannah's anxiety over having no children, even though Elkanah loves her, parallels Israel's anxiety over having no king in spite of the care and the love of God. And what God shows us through Hannah is relevant for every Christian today whose faith seems barren. It is true for barren churches, as a church in the West, including America, can largely be considered today bearing very little of the harvest of holiness and the zeal for the truth that God truly desires. And as we continue in Hannah's story, she will be a model for us, the grace-seeking prayer that we need to offer to God. But in these opening verses, we see another central point. For in a time when Israel as a whole had forgotten the Lord, 1 Samuel 1:3 says, "This man used to go up year by year from his city to worship and to sacrifice to the Lord of hosts at Shiloh, where the two sons of Eli, Hophni and Phinehas, were priests of the Lord." Now, Shiloh was the location of the tabernacle and the Ark of the Covenants in Elkanah's time. Eli was hardly an impressive spiritual leader, and his wicked sons, Hophni and Phinehas, made a mockery of the ministry, as we will see in 1 Samuel 2. Elkanah did not go up to Shiloh to see Eli or his sons, but to come before the Lord and renew his covenant fidelity. Elkanah did what we must also do. He prioritized the place of God in his life and gave attention to the Lord. And yet, little Elkanah knew of true religion at a time like this. He knew enough, though, to come as a sinner seeking grace from God by means of the shed blood of a sacrifice. This is how salvation begins for any barren soul. It begins with realizing that we must get right with God. Sinners come to the cross of Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God, to whom the old sacrifice pointed, seeking forgiveness through his atoning blood and renewal through his redeeming grace. Spiritually barren Christians come back to the cross, confessing to God their sin and their spiritual neglect, and find cleansing and acceptance through Christ's once and for all sacrifice. This is what God desired from Israel, a sincere and repentant seeking after him and his grace, for which purpose he had afflicted them with the barrenness of the time of the judges, and which he reflected in the childless condition of godly Hannah. And when we see Hannah's tears shed not for her own, but for Israel's failings, we should grieve for our own sins and the barren lives they cause. Her deliverance will likewise remind us of God's redeeming love and the transforming power that is available to us today in the grace of God. Now, the theology of Hannah's barren condition would have been little on her heart, however, as she returned to the tabernacle with her family. It was a dysfunctional family, primarily because Hannah was not Elkanah's only wife. 1 Samuel 1:2 says that he had two wives. The name of the one was Hannah and the other Penai. And Penai had children, but Hannah had no children. Now, the practice of polygamy is frequently seen throughout the Old Testament, though it was not the norm. The book of Genesis makes it clear that God designed marriage to be between one man and one woman for a whole life under God, Genesis 2:24 says, a definition that is confirmed by Jesus Christ in Matthew 19:5. Elkanah's polygamy was provoked, possibly, by Hannah's inability to bear children, which threatened both the economic hardship and the cutting off of his name and his lineage. Therefore, like the patriarchs Abraham and Jacob, Elkanah took a second wife to bear him children, while his affections remained fixed on Hannah. And the emotional divide in this marriage that necessarily followed corresponds to the names of the two wives, Hannah, whose name means gracious, and Peninnah, whose name means prolific. Polygamy always causes family conflict, but much more certainly when one wife receives affection and the other receives children. And no, I'm not saying that polygamy is God's design. I already just said that Genesis 2:24 makes it clear that marriage is between one man and one woman for life under God. It is a covenant. So the discord in Elkanah's house mirrors the intertribal dissension within Israel and reminds us all of the importance of family and church unity. Hannah's emotional distress over her barren womb would have been grief enough without Peninnah to goad her. Her trial is familiar to women today who suffer an inability, sadly, to bear children. She had never had the thrill of bringing the news of a pregnancy to her husband, but had instead known the monthly frustration of infertility. And whenever she went to the marketplace or socialized with other families, the sound of infant voices, the very sound she most desired, plunged into her heart like a knife. William Blake adds that the trial which Hannah had to bear was particularly heavy to a Hebrew woman. To have no child was not only a disappointment, but seemed to make one out as dishonored by God, as unworthy of any part or lot in the means that were to bring about the fulfillment of the promise in Genesis 12:3. In thee and in thy seed shall all the families of the earth be blessed. It is always cruel and almost always unwarranted to assume another affliction as a sign of God's disfavor, especially a trial so painful to a woman's heart. But since children were considered a sign of God's favor, Deuteronomy 7:14 says, and since the Mosaic law listed barren wombs as one sign of God's curse for covenant breaking in Deuteronomy 28:18, childless women were often scorned in female society, depriving them of the emotional support that they needed. All this was Hannah's bitter portion, month by month and year by year. And then there was Peninnah. And while Hannah had Elkanah's heart, Peninnah had his children, and she missed no opportunity to inflict misery on this account. 1 Samuel 1, 6-7 says, Hannah's rival used to provoke her grievously to irritate her, because the Lord had closed her womb, and so it went on year by year. A typical example is what took place during this visit to Shiloh. 1 Samuel 1, 4-5 says this, on the day when Elkanah sacrificed, he would give portions to Peninnah, his wife, and to all her sons and daughters. But to Hannah he gave a double portion because he loved her. The Lord had closed her womb. Now we can imagine Elkanah's quandary. Should he distribute all the portions for Peninnah and her many children, but only one to Hannah? And in order to express his sympathy and love, he gave Hannah a double portion. And this sign of special favor enraged Peninnah, inciting her to savage mockery. Perhaps this was delivered backhandedly, as imagined by Dale Ralph Davis. Now, do all you children have your food? Dear me, there are so many of you. It's hard to keep track. Mommy, Miss Hannah doesn't have any children. What did you say, dear? I said, Miss Hannah doesn't have any children. Miss Hannah, oh yes, that's right. She doesn't have any children. But does she want children? Oh yes, she wants children very, very much. Wouldn't you say so, Hannah? Don't you just wish you had children, too? Doesn't Daddy want Miss Hannah to have kids? Oh, certainly he does, but Miss Hannah keeps disappointing him. She doesn't have any kids. Well, why not? What? Why? Because God won't let her. Does God not like Miss Hannah? Well, I don't know. What do you think? Well, this imagined conversation may or may not reflect Peninnah's actual strategy for inflicting Hannah's heart, though it does fit the Bible's description that Peninnah would provoke her grievously to irritate her to the point of tears, 1 Samuel 1, 6-7 says. So a loathsome heart like Peninnah's calls for our reflection, especially since it bears such a resemblance to our own hearts. You see, to suffer in the tenderest part of one's nature is no doubt a heavy affliction, but to have a heart eager to inflict such suffering on another is far more awful. And we need to be warned. This is a warning to all who play the part of Hannah's fellow wife, who mock those who suffer and lord over those who are cast down. You may succeed for the moment, and you may experience whatever satisfaction can be found in a gloated revenge. But know this, that you have been cherishing a viper in your own bosom that will not content itself with fulfilling your desire. It will make itself a habitual residence in your heart and distill its poison over it. The Elkanah's second wife would conduct herself in such a way during a visit to the tabernacle reminds us that the outward show of religion without an inward correspondence will often be a mask for the most spiteful of hearts. At a time, however, Panai must have felt quite the sensation of triumph. The truth is that our tongues can drive others into despair. We read this simply that Hannah wept and would not eat, 1 Samuel 1:7 says. In the very place where hope should reign, the house of God, Hannah experienced only distress. The church sanctuary is sometimes the most depressing place for those who feel singled out by their trials, though it is also the place they need the most hope. Realizing this, Christians are reminded to be thoughtful of the afflictions, to be sensitive in our conduct and speech, and while rejoicing in our own blessings, to go out of our way to provide heartfelt sympathy and support to those who grieve. Pastors should likewise aim to be sensitive to broken hearts like Hannah's when they lead in pastoral prayers. In general, worship in the church should not assume a lighthearted happiness in all the worshipers, but should reflect and embrace the full range of human emotions as the covenant community meets with the Lord God. And even here at the beginning of her story, there are signs of hope for Hannah. The first sign of hope is the very statement about God's involvement that many dread about their afflictions. 1 Samuel 1:5 says, "The Lord had closed her womb." You see, instead of resenting God's sovereignty in our trials, we Christians should lift up our hearts. Our God has proved his faithfulness and love by sending his own son to die for our sins. In Hannah's day, he was known as the God who was faithful to deliver Israel from bondage in Egypt, and who was mighty in securing them for them the promised land. Rather than assuming some unholy, spiteful, or condemning purpose in God's afflictions, Christians need to remember that God is holy, and so all his deeds are holy. God is good, and so he intends our sorrows for good. And God is filled with mercy for the brokenhearted. God does not seek to destroy us through our trials, but to save us through our trials. As Hannah herself would later testify in 1 Samuel 2:8, he raises up the poor from the dust. He lifts the needy from the ash heap. And so if God is the one who closed the womb, we should take heart, since he can surely also open it. You see, in Hannah's case, God was using her plight to orchestrate Israel's deliverance from the dark area of the judges. This was a cause dear to Hannah's heart, as we know from the song she would later lift up in praise to God in 1 Samuel 2:10. Now, we may never know how God has worked throughout our most bitter trials to bring others to salvation, to equip us with sensitivity and ministry to others, or even to launch a significant gospel advance. But we do know God, and we know from his word the truth of Romans 28, which says, "For those who love God, all things work together for good." And so we can have confidence in God's purpose for our lives. And a famous example from church history is a tearful experience of Monica, the mother of the early church's greatest theologian, Augustine of Hippo. As a devoted Christian, Monica was grieved by her brilliant son's disdain for the gospel, and even more so for the sexually dissolute life that she witnessed him leading. Night after night, she pleaded with the Lord for Augustine. One night was especially trying, for in the morning, her son planned to board a ship for Rome, where a young man could be expected to plunge deeply into sin. All night she prayed, and when Monica arose in the morning to find her son gone, she wept bitterly before the Lord. Little did she know that in Italy, her son would come under the influence of the noted preacher Ambrose of Milan, and that during his stay there, he would be converted to faith in Jesus Christ. And moreover, the very wickedness over which this faithful mother grieved provided Augustine with a keen appreciation for God's grace in salvation. In fact, his teaching of salvation by grace alone would have a profound influence on generations of later Christians, including a direct influence on men used by God to lead the Protestant Reformation. So take heart then if you grieve under afflictions, to know that God has willed them for you. John Chrysostom, the great preacher of the early church, wrote of the sorrows like Hannah's. Even if we are suffering grief and pain, even if the trouble seems insupportable to us, Let us not be anxious or beside ourselves, but wait on God's providence. He is well aware, after all, when is a time for what is causing us depression to be removed. It was not out of hatred, in fact, or of revulsion that God closed Hannah's womb, but to open to us the doors on the values the woman possessed, and for us to espy the riches of her faith, and to realize he rendered her more fruitful on that account. See, the second cause for Hannah's hope was a tender love displayed to her husband, Elkanah. 1 Samuel 1:8 says this, Elkanah, her husband, said to her, Hannah, why do you weep, and why do you not eat, and why is your heart sad? Am I not more to you than 10 sons? So before we can turn to his words, we should not overlook the simple fact that Elkanah went to his wife. How comforting it is to simply to be present with those who suffer. Our mere presence with the sick, the troubled, and the grieving is often more powerful than any words. And when he did speak, Elkanah made to Hannah the essential point that he loved her very much and her inability to not sour him towards her. If others are scorned, she could draw strength from her husband's solidarity. And though she might easily fear losing everything because of her barren womb, Elkanah reminded her that she would not lose his love. Now, as is typical of men who are sometimes, let's be honest, guys, inept concerning women's hearts, Elkanah's words are not above criticism and might even be considered self-centered. Notice that he says to her, am I not more to you than 10 sons? Rather than saying, you are worth more to me than 10 sons, sweetheart. And so will often be that those well-meaning friends may not know what to say, and they may not say it, may say it imperfectly or even worse, but there is one whose comfort does not fail and whose remedy does not err. And the final cause for Hannah's hope lay in the Lord and in the reality that she had not, in fact, given up her faith in him. Great as Elkanah's love for Hannah was, there was still a greater love than his, and a comforter who could do what her husband never could, one who could answer Hannah's plea and grant her the desire of her heart. We sometimes suspect that a broken heart like Hannah's would have little concern for theology, and yet it is at times like these that we most need the truths we have learned about God. Just as the people of Israel had descended into idolatry because they had forgotten the Lord, so Hannah most needed to remember the Lord. She needed theology, that is, the knowledge of God's characters and his ways. And there is good reason to suspect that while Hannah's heart wept, her mind was reflecting on the Bible. Perhaps she remembered how God had so often granted special sons through the barren wombs of believing women. She would have certainly have known about how God gave the covenant heir, Isaac, through Abraham's wife, Sarah, though she was not only barren, but well beyond childbearing age. She would also have known about how Isaac prayed for his barren wife, Rebecca, and she gave birth to twin boys, including Jacob, the father of Israel. Jacob's wife, too, suffered childlessness. In fact, Rachel suffered in a situation similar to Hannah's because of the malice of her sister and co-wife, Leah, who, though little loved, was prolific in childbearing. But God remembered Rachel and answered her prayer by giving her Joseph, the greatest of Jacob's sons, along with Benjamin, the most beloved. You see, the prevalence of barren wombs among women most blessed by God may have caught Hannah's attention. And if so, she may have realized that a son whom she could bear could be of special importance to God. This idea is suggested by the prayer that Hannah goes on to offer in 1 Samuel 2, 1-10. And the biblical theme of God's blessing on the barren womb makes the important point that God saves not by human capability, human achievement, or even human working. God saves by grace. God causes the barren womb to bear children, just as he causes the lifeless heart to believe. And God thus calls his people not to trust human wisdom and human effort, and not to despair in the face of human failure, but to trust the Lord God, who gives life to the dead and salvation through the barren womb. Hannah's affliction, like ours, was therefore a call to faith in God. Her weakness was a call to reliance on the power of God. Her failure was a call to believe in God's faithfulness, and her grief was a call to seek for God's grace. Grateful though Hannah might be for her husband's love, her true hope lay in a greater love than his. Her hope lay in the Lord God, whose whole record of dealing with Israel was one of faithfulness, power, and grace. Our true hope in all of our trials, and especially in the burden of our guilt for sin, is that the same God, the God who has revealed his love forever by sending his own Son to redeem us by his blood. Indeed, when the time came for our Savior to be born, he was conceived by the Holy Spirit, not in a barren womb like Hannah's, but in the virgin womb of Mary, proving that nothing is impossible for our God. Ralph Davis says this: when his people are without strength, without resources, without hope, without human gimmicks, then God loves to stretch forth his hand from heaven. Once we see where God often begins, we will understand how we may be encouraged. King David once asked himself in Psalm 43:5, "Why are you downcast, O my soul, and why are you in turmoil within me? His answer is the answer that we will see revealed through the faith of Hannah, an answer that all who know the Lord can come to embrace in every trial. Hope in God, for I shall again praise him, my salvation and my God." You know, this text is a challenging one. It's challenging not only, to be clear, to pronounce some of the words in, but it's challenging because here we have the Lord. It says in verse 6, the Lord had closed her womb. You know, my wife and I, we have not yet had children, and that's a hard subject. This is a very hard subject for me to talk about, and one that I've never talked about in public. But it's difficult. It's caused me to have tears. It's been a test of my faith and my confidence in God. It's my confidence, it's my trust in the Lord. As I've been studying this passage in the last few weeks to prepare for this time up for this study, I've been reminded of truths that we just talked about today. God's timing is perfect. The Psalms tell us that God's ways are perfect and just and holy and good, and that God's desire is to conform us into the image of Christ. I want to tell you something that I've literally never said in public, but I have said to my wife many, many times in private. And that is this: whether we have kids or not, that's not the point of our marriage. The point of our marriage is, I'm going to love you. I'm going to care for you. I'm going to love you and care for you because of Christ. And whether we have kids or not, I want you to know that I love you with my whole heart. And you see here, the point, well, I believe firmly that one of the purposes of marriage is procreation. The purpose of marriage is to help us grow to be like Christ. As men, we are commanded. It's not an option, Paul says in Ephesians 5. He tells us five times we are to love our wives. That's a command. It's not an option. What God commands, he also supplies the grace to accomplish. He provides the fuel for our obedience by the grace of God. I say that to say this, all of this. Today, you might not have kids, and this message is hurtful. It hurts you. You struggle to work through this. Can I just say, I am there, right there with you. I know, I don't know your specific pain, but I know the pain of not having kids. My wife and I have been married 12 years. We do not have children. But can I also say this? God is faithful to his promises. Hebrews 13:5 is a very great comfort to me. It says this: that God is faithful to his word. He will never leave us. He will never forsake us. God is faithful. We can bank all of our lives on the faithfulness of God, because all of the ways of God are holy and just and good. I don't know if my wife and I are going to be able to have kids, but God does. If you haven't had kids, God knows that too. Maybe you've even had a miscarriage. And God knows that too. God knows the pain of that. I've had many friends go through a miscarriage. My wife and I, we've never even gotten that far. And you know what? I can take comfort in the fact that the Bible tells us that God sees and that God knows and that God loves. That all the purposes of God are for my good. Why? Well, it's not because I'm sufficient in myself. It's because the grace of God is sufficient. And that is the same for you today. My heart hurts for those who can't have children. Not only because, well, we don't know if we can't have children, just to be clear about that. But God hasn't given us our children yet. We've been married 12 years. So I'm familiar with the pain of not having children and wanting to have children. But more than that, if you're a guy and you're listening to this and you don't have children, you've been married 10 years or 5 years or so, I want to encourage you to tell your wife, sweetheart, I love you. I love you more than having kids. I'm going to be there for you. I'm going to walk with you through all the days of my life and love you with the grace of God. You know, what means more than having kids is loving our God. Loving the Lord our God with all of our heart, with all of our mind, and with all of our strength. Loving our neighbor, loving our spouse. This is where the command to love our spouse comes from loving our neighbor. Our neighbor is our wife. You know, and the church needs to come alongside and to pray and to encourage. And, you know, I've often had friends ask me, well, why don't you guys have kids? You know what? My answer is this. God is sovereign. God is sovereign. His timing is perfect. All the ways of the Lord are perfect, holy, good, and just. All of my confidence, my hope, is not ultimately in having a child. It is in God. God's timing is perfect. And the same is true for you if you're a Christian today. That all the ways of the Lord are perfect and good and holy and just. I don't know what God's plan is for you. But I do know this, what the Bible says. That God's ways are holy and just and perfect and good. And you can bank your bottom dollar on that. You can bank the whole weight of your whole life, can bear the whole weight of that burden, because our God is holy and just and good. You know, it's a sadness to not have kids yet. But it's an even more infinite sadness when we place our confidence, our hope more in having kids than in the God who can open the womb. Our God is sovereign. He can open the womb. He can close it. He owns the cattle on 1,000 hills. He is the one who knows the very hairs on our head. He knows down to the very hour and the second of our lives. And so what I want to say in closing is this, and I've been reflecting and thinking long and hard about this week, is that this, God is sovereign. In this life, we will not have neat and nice answers to why all these things happen. But we do know what God has said. We do know what God has said in his word and how he has revealed himself. We know the character of God. And we can trust in that. We can hope in that. We can place our hope in the Lord. As our psalm said, we can hope in God. We can hope in God. And I don't know where you're at today. I do know that for many of you, this will be a hard sermon, this hard study to hear. But here again, Psalm 43, verse 5. Hope in God, for I shall again praise him, my salvation and my God. See, God is good. We can hope in him. Whether God opens the womb or closes the womb, or whether you lose a child, God is good. Our hope is in him. He is good. And that desire to have children is good. It comes from a good God. But sometimes in our lives, and we don't understand all of why. But Deuteronomy 29:29 says that the secret things belong to the Lord. God, sometimes in his sovereignty, he gives and he takes away. You know, there was a friend of mine, a good, very good friend of mine, at my previous church in Southern Idaho. He tragically lost his son. He and his wife did. Over a illness, over disease. You know, how we respond as the people of God in that situation, it says everything about our faith. It says everything about our confidence. And I want to say, even though I was over half an hour, 45 minutes away, I hopped in the car when I heard it, drove to the hospital. I told him, I looked him in the face and I said, you know what? I am so sorry that this happened. I am so sorry that this happened. And I want you to know that I'm going to be there for you. I'm going to walk alongside of you. And more importantly than that, I want you to know that God loves you. And that even in this, God has a plan and God has a purpose. You know, those words are not only true for me, for my friend. They are true for you because they are grounded in God's word. God's plan is perfect. His ways are perfect. He is good. He is faithful and true. And he will accomplish all that he wishes. And whether we have kids or not, whether we get our dreams or not, whether everything in our life goes the way that we want, which it likely won't, most likely, most definitively not. God is good. God is faithful. God is just. God is holy. God is God. And we can hope in him. That is of infinite importance. Infinitely greater than anything that the world can give us, anything that this life can give us, that we can hope in God. So it's there that I leave you. There that our hope is. Our hope is because of Christ, who shed his blood on our behalf, in our place, and for our sin. And he was buried and he rose again. And even right now we can take comfort in the fact that as Christians we have one who stands as our advocate. He ever lives to plead the merits of his own blood, the treasure trove of his blood before the Father as our high priest and our advocate. He right now is making intercession for you. So take heart, dear Christian friend. Take heart. Look to Christ. Hope in God. Stir your new affections afresh in this hope that we have. Would you pray with me now? Lord, we have talked about a very difficult subject today. I thank you for the grace to talk about it. I thank you that you continue to help me, even in this. Your grace superabounds, as Paul prays, says in Ephesians 1. And so, Lord, we thank you that we can come to a God whose height and depth know no limits, no bounds, are unconstrained by time and space. And yet you summon us before the throne of grace to come in time of need. And Lord, I pray for those who are struggling with infertility and miscarriages today. God, would you help us to hope in God? Would you help those who haven't had children to hope in God? Would you help us to see that our supreme joy is not even in a child, but in the Lord God, whose ways, your ways are perfect, your ways are good, your ways are just, your ways are holy. Help our confidence to be in that. Help our hope to be in that. Help us to see that we have an infinite, supreme, unending joy because of Christ alone. We thank you, Lord, for this word for your word, even though it's so challenging. It hits home. It pierces our hearts. So God, bring healing through the word. By your spirit, bring comfort to those who are hurting today, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen.